Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call to order the regular scheduled council meeting for Monday, November 7th, 2016, at 7 p.m. Caller? Mayor Lally?
Here.
Mr. McIntyre?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsey?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lally?
Here.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Here.
Mr. Craybacher?
Here.
All members present.
Sir, you stand while tonight's invocation by Councilman Dillon.
Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight in Jesus' name. Father, we ask you to keep an eye over this council this evening, Father. Let us do what's the best for the citizens and this city, Lord. Father, we ask you to bless our armed service people, our police officers, and our firefighters. Lord, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And we use the flag in the back tonight, the pledge.
The pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Need actions on the minutes for October 17th, 2016. All members second.
Any questions or comments, council?
Mr. Caller?
Mr. Rick Lally?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lally?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Minutes past 7 to 0.
Thank you, sir. And tonight, before we move on, I'm sure most of you thought about when we have to discuss some sad news tonight. Tonight will be Councilman McIntyre's last meeting with us here in New Carlisle. Bill's done a lot of good for the city. He's a super smart young man, and he's taught me a lot. I think he's taught us all, you know, a lot of things since he's been here. He's definitely going to be missed. So I'll let you take that over.
Oh, okay.
Let you say
what more could a kid from Medway ask for? This is so great. I just want to thank all you guys and everyone up here on council, Mr. Zambach, Ms. Manneman, for all the great times we've had, all the work we've done for the city. The city administration, bang for your buck, we have the best city manager in the Miami Valley, guarantee you that. And I want to thank all the residents, all the voters for two votes of confidence twice electing me to be up here. This huge honor is something I always cherish. Right now, I guess I'm going to take some time off and be a husband and a dad, which is something I kind of put on the back burner over the last 11 years, and that's important too. So again, I just want to thank everyone for everything. It's we had our ups and downs, and I think we did a lot of good. And everyone up here, everyone on that side, and all the people watching, all the people sitting, and all the people who are going to look at this on YouTube or read about it in New Carlisle News, we all contributed to making New Carlisle great. And I want to thank you all for that. And I ask that whoever sits in this seat coming up in the future, if you could give them the same level of help and all the stuff you provided for me, pass that along to him or her, whoever that may be. And again, thank you so much. And this will always be my hometown. Thank you.
Anybody else have anything like to say before we move on this evening?
I would. Bill, we're going to miss you. Really thank you. You have put your heart in New Carlisle, and we appreciated it. And we will definitely miss you, but I'm sure you're going on to bigger and better things. And the two things you said a moment ago, family is very important. And I'm glad to see that you're going to be taking care of that. That's good. So God bless. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Kirkland. I've known Bill for ever since he was little guy.
Very little guy.
Yeah. Very little guy. And matter of fact, at one time we thought we were going to be relatives.
That is true.
However, that's not happening. So, but you know, Bill knows what I think of him. I love Bill like a brother. And mostly like a son too. So, it was a pleasure. It was really a pleasure to have him sitting up here. So, Bill, I wish you luck. I know I'll see you sometime.
Yeah, I'll see you around. So.
Yeah.
Sam, right back at you.
Yeah. All right.
Good day.
Sure. Bill.
I put a post on your page last night, I'm sure you read it, at least I hope you did, and I can't say much more than that, except to tell you thanks. Stop back to see us sometime, and thanks for all you've done for the city of McLeod.
Thanks so much.
Appreciate it. Good luck to you.
Thanks.
Sure.
So Bill and I got elected together at the same time, and when I first got on council, I remember I was talking with him. This guy is incredibly intelligent, part of none. I'm definitely going to miss you. I mean, the things he's done for New Carlisle with the community garage sale, which we've never done before. We had environmental concerns that we addressed with R.D. Holder that he brought up. I mean, just a wealth of information. But one thing I won't miss is the history lesson.
Sure.
That's all I've ever done.
All right. So, okay. Mr. Bird, we'll move on if you're ready. And Dale, thanks again for everything. Thank you very much.
We do have some guests in. Are we ready to go on communications, Mr. Mayor?
When you're ready, sir.
Okay. We do have some guests in here, Michelle Jordan and Dennis Bernie-Sias. Thank you very much for the assist there. They're from CCA Division of Taxation, City of Cleveland. They are here to give a brief overview of what they can do for the city of New Carlisle. As I'm sure everyone in the room does know, we do have an ordinance on place to begin outsourcing our income tax collections. So let's give the floor to Mr. Dennis back there, and thanks a lot for coming down. We truly do appreciate it.
And I appreciate this opportunity. Mayor, members of council, thank you for allowing me the opportunity to speak to you. I have a presentation here that can go as much as 90 minutes to 2 hours. I'm going to try and keep it as short as possible. I believe that Randy Bridges has already given you a lot of the information I would normally cover. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't be here. So let's start with, who is the CCA? What are they? The CCA originally was named the Central Collection Agency. However, collection agency has taken on a negative feeling over the last couple of decades, quite different from what it was when we were created by the city of Cleveland in 1966. The important thing to know is that the CCA Division of Taxation is a division of the city of Cleveland's finance department, and that all of our employees are employees of the city of Cleveland. We are not a separate entity. We are not a for-profit organization. We are a creation of the city of Cleveland, operating in the manner of an enterprise fund would operate if you were collecting water or sewer charges or your electric company. The revenue we generate goes back into operating so that we do not have a profit margin or any markups on our services. We actually function as a cooperative. By that I mean we track the total transactions that we have for all member communities, and we compare that number of transactions for each individual community as a percentage of the transactions for all member communities, and we take that percentage, and then we track the percentage of dollars collected for any individual community, and compare that as a percentage of total dollars collected for all communities. Those two factors are then averaged, and whatever that percentage is, that is used, applied to our total operating cost, and that becomes that given community's operating cost, and that is the amount they are charged. So you can see it is not a negotiated price, it is actually a function of our operating expenses versus the amount of use that your community makes use of our facilities. As simple as that. Why do we do this? Economy of scale. Sometimes to buy in bulk is cheaper. To do things for everybody in a large group lowers the costs for each individual community, and that is the objective of it, and that is what we've been doing since 1966. For your community, the way we start out is we hold back 2% of revenue for the first year and a half. Because for the first year and a half, we do not know what the percentages will be to come up with an accurate calculation. After we have gone through our annual audit, which usually happens April, May of each year, we know what the percentages will be, and we calculate the actual cost to your community, compared to the revenues, and we adjust it. And then going forward from there, we know what your costs will be based on hitting it as we develop a history, and we can adjust the holdback to accommodate the actual costs that you are incurring. Now, generally speaking, we average a 2%. For some communities, I think it was closer to 3 or 3.5%. Again, it's always a projection because we have no history to base it on from your community. One important thing to note is this fee is the only fee that we charge you. We do not do additional service charges. There is no charge to convert your data so that it works on our system. However, your software company may charge you to prepare the reports and the data for communication to CCA. We don't control that. That's because it's your software company. Other than that, all of our functions are included in the cost. Now, what does that include? Number one, first thing to keep in mind is we are administering your tax ordinance. We are not requiring you to modify your ordinance to accommodate our organization. The tax ordinance that your council creates is the one that we enforce. When we are enforcing your ordinance, we turn to your administration for guidance on how you want to handle certain issues. Among those issues is the application of the ordinance regarding penalties and interest. Generally speaking, if somebody wants to challenge or ask for a waiver of penalty and interest, we do not do that. It is your administration who makes the determination whether or not anything is waived. It is your administration's decision on policies that affect your community. Recently, you passed new legislation for your tax ordinance to accommodate House Bill 5. You made elections when you passed that ordinance. We will accommodate those elections. So what else do we do? Well, first off, we do full administration. We do all the mailings, we supply the tax returns, we contact your taxpayers, we send out the bills. We have online ability for filing, so most taxpayers can file online from our website. Tax returns, forms, rules, regulations are all available online. People can make payments online. If they want, we have an 800 number they can call up. They can make payments online, or I'm sorry, through the 800 number if they want to call in and put it on a credit card. If an individual is having a problem filling out the tax return, they can call our office. Our people will walk them through the tax return line by line to help them fill it out. In addition, during the tax season, we will have representatives, we will schedule CCA staff members to come here to fill out tax returns for your residents who want to have their tax return prepared by us. In addition, we have an office in Dayton, which, I don't know, what's the drive time from here, Michelle?
20 minutes, 25.
Yeah, so you're about 15 minutes to a half hour away from a permanent office in Dayton where they can receive help. What else do you do? We take care of delinquencies. We match up state regulations. We get information from the state of Ohio or who is filed with the state of Ohio and compare that to the data we have from your community to make sure that we are not missing anybody. I mean, the name of the game is making sure people don't fall through the cracks. The big thing that we have is federal tax information. About 20 years ago, the federal government said the IRS may share federal income tax information with communities with a population of 250,000 or more. About 10 years ago, they changed the regulations to say that if the aggregate population for all the communities that we serve exceeds 250,000, we can include all the communities in that information, which means that we now have the ability, and have had the ability for 10 years, to take a look and match up residents from New Carlisle and compare the information that has been filed with the IRS to the tax information that is being filed for the Carlisle to look for discrepancies. And again, we do not charge extra for these services. This is part of our routine. The way this would work in the simplest manner would be, the first thing we'll do is take a look at all the filings that we received for the first year that we're filing for you. And then we will take a look at the federal tax returns for 1040s filed for the zip code in New Carlisle, limited by the addresses that your administration will identify as the boundaries, so that we know who lives in New Carlisle and who does not. And we'll simply go through the federal tax returns. If they're on the federal tax rolls and they're already filing with us, that's the end of it. If they're not on the federal, on our rolls, but they're filing a federal tax return, we have the ability to look at their income and say, is it taxable income? If the only source of income is Social Security, pensions, interest, dividends, items that are not taxable by you, we are not going to pursue those people. This, we do this in order to avoid contacting your senior citizens who don't, who basically may have to file a federal tax return, but will not owe any taxes. We are going to focus on those people who have taxable income. We will contact those people, and we will pursue those people to make sure they file the required tax returns. Additional programs that we run is a matching of income. We will take a look to see who's reporting income to the city but has other income on their federal tax return that was not reported for New Carlisle. Examples of somebody who may have a small self-employment, rental property, or something of that nature, and sometimes that gets overlooked when they file the city return. We look at that information and again contact those people and ask for a corrected tax return. That's the federal tax program. That is one of our biggest projects. Because of its size, we do not run it every year. We run it every 3 to 5 years for each community, but it will be one of the things that we will do for your community. Other things that you have is that you will have a liaison assigned to your community. There will be a person in our office who will be the specialist on New Carlisle. That person will be the go-to person for your administration if something comes up. Administration will have access through our community access program to tax information for New Carlisle. However, there are restrictions on this, number one being that the information that the administration has access to should only be accessed by a person that you appoint to be your functional tax administrator. In the same way that your in-house tax department could not share any tax information with anybody else, your tax administrator, who is named by you, cannot share that information with anybody else either. All the same restrictions will apply on that data. In the same way that at our level, all of our people sign anti-disclosure statements, because it is illegal for any of our employees to disclose any tax information that is collected by the city on CCA. We will deposit accounts to your revenue to your account, less the holdback, on a monthly basis. We have the 800 number, and basically that's the short version. And again, if you have questions, please.
Okay. I have a comment, if I can get you to verify this, but when we had the meeting, the one thing I had brought up is we have a high Hispanic speaking population in the city limits of New Carlisle, and I would like for you to let council know that you do have a bilingual.
We do have bilingual individuals on staff
that will come up here during tax season to assist.
Mr. Bird, before we get up, does the citizens have
this
left
there
by chance?
No, probably not. Okay. They had it in the last packet.
Okay.
It was in the last packet.
Okay, Council.
Mr.
Lowers?
I didn't hear you mention delinquent taxes.
Okay. We pursue delinquent taxes. Number one, obviously, when the tax return payment is supposed to be enclosed. We also bill automatically for those people who declare an estimated tax, and we will bill them quarterly for the estimated tax that they declare. One important issue is if somebody does not declare an estimated tax on the tax return, that is read as a zero declaration, so they are not billed for estimated taxes. We do not force an estimate on somebody who does not complete that line on the tax return. Now, on delinquencies, we send out notices to everybody who has a balance due. We call these red bills because the ink is red. We will send multiple bills on that to contact the individuals, pointing out to them that there's a liability and that there's amount due. After we have exhausted our normal bills for this, it goes back to the community, it goes back to you to make decisions on how you want to proceed. One of those things that we are now is new with us is we are working with the state of Ohio. As you may know, the Attorney General can certify, we can certify notes to the Attorney General, who will then institute collection procedures to collect past due amounts. That will, the letters will come from the state of Ohio, and their staff will do the collections work for you. There is a fee. We set up the process, and we will walk you through the paperwork, but they will not deal with us as a third-party administrator. It has to be done through your community. But we'll hold your hand through the entire process. It's just that you must make the decisions, and you must say you want to do this. If you elect to use a, if you elect to take people to court, filing civil or criminal charges, it's your call. It's made by your administration. Who to file the suits against or charges. We will, if it does happen, we will provide all of the documentation your solicitor or your attorney needs to pursue those cases. If you need somebody to show in court to testify about the ordinance, about our procedures, about the tax return, to discuss the payments, we will provide, one of our staff members will come down here with the file, go to court, and answer the questions. Again, these are included. This is not an extra fee for doing this. This is included in our standard fee. Does that answer?
Yes, it does. Thank you. Mr. Waddell. Did you have something you'd like to add?
Yes, if I could add one thing to that, there's one additional step. As a matter of fact, we're getting ready to do this.
I'm sorry, can you go to the podium? There's a microphone up there. I'm sorry. And that's Michelle Jordan, everyone.
Thank you. There's one additional step that we're actually getting ready to do in our office right now, and that's called our RB subpoena program. Before we turn the counts back over to you, we order everybody in to resolve outstanding balances. And I have about 200 people who are subpoenaed in the first 2 weeks in December. Those notices are going out tomorrow, and those are for communities in this area. That gives us another opportunity to help people get into payment plans, get tax balances taken care of, outstanding issues resolved before we turn that back over. So that's an additional step.
Thank you.
And what was that step called, Michelle? I'm sorry.
RB subpoena.
RB subpoena.
Mr. McLaughlin, would you like to say something about that first before I go?
Well, no, I've just been looking at it over and over. I have known just from what I've been reading and looking through our packets, I don't have any doubts of the quality of work that your group does. Just basically, to me, it's going to come down to numbers. I mean, I have no doubt that you guys are going to do your job and do it well. It just comes down to the savings versus in-house versus outsourcing it. Looks like an estimated cost to the city of $34,667.48. And if that's true,
that's a savings.
Right, savings. That looks really good. I just want to make sure that that's...
Yeah. And another thing, too, I really want council to pay attention here is, yes, we're going to see savings. And those are estimated numbers. We can expect it goes up or down. We're not going to know unless we try it for a year or two. But the big thing about this is we can hire another full-time staff and keep it in-house, but we're going to get more bang for our buck by having CCA do this for us. It's based on the what I call bonus items that we can't do in-house. And the big one that is that cross-comparison to the federal database. That is huge. Right now, our income tax is our big moneymaker for the city. That truly is. It's not economic development. It's income tax. That's where we get our money. You know, we need to focus on how we make that better while decreasing how much we pay to do so.
Let me, Randy, I don't think you would know this because you weren't here. Maybe these three might know. Didn't the city do, just maybe 10 years ago or so, do something similar to this law?
I don't really remember we going to outsource.
Tax collection.
It was, I thought the tax collection was outsourced.
Oh, we were, it was just.
Yes, that was outsourced.
Just the.
Just the back. Okay.
That's true.
My question is, how many communities in our general area would be, that are you working with now? Are you working with any from our area?
Michelle?
Yes, right now, we do full administration for West Milton, Clayton, Union, West Alexandria. And then we have about 12 communities in the area that we have in a different type of membership. In previous years, we had offered a special membership. So we do a lot of work for Dayton, Springfield, a lot of other communities as well.
Did she say Dayton? Mm-hmm. Did it say the Dayton area? I don't know.
Yeah, we do some special delinquency work for Dayton, for the city of Dayton.
You also said you work for a lot of school districts. Is that correct?
No.
Not school districts?
No, this is just municipal income tax, just for cities and villages.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. McIntyre.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I have a question for you. First of all, thank you for being here. I do appreciate you coming down here. Then I have a couple questions for Mr. Bridge if that's an appropriate time related to this. First of all, thanks for letting us know the different communities that do this, the number of communities that do this. What sort of feedback are you generally hearing from them about this process?
I think they've been very happy with the work that we've done. As a matter of fact, today I just did a subpoena program in the city of, or the village of Waynesfield, where it's a special additional project that we did on some delinquency work for them. We go above and beyond. We look outside the box. We don't just do the work we do. We do everything we can to make sure the tax money is being collected.
So it's been mostly positive or overwhelmingly positive?
I would say so, yes.
Okay, thank you. And then Mr. Bridge, the question is for you. Two of them. One, if we go this route and I look at the savings that Mayor Lowry brought up here, it's about $34,000, $35,000, which is roughly the cost, of, you know, not including insurance and retirement benefits of an employee. I was wondering, if we went this route, is anyone going to lose their job because of this?
No. Actually, I brought in by our tax administrator here, Vicki Taylor. She did retire. We did hire her back. Right now, we have an agreement with her. She's going to stay on until June, and then we're going to reanalyze her position at that. But she will be on until June to help with that conversion. She has a lot of years of experience. At that point in time, we will reanalyze if we're going to go essentially offer Ms. Taylor a full-time job or bring somebody else up.
So we're not, no one's going to...
No, we'll always have a tax administrator on staff.
Great.
Yes.
And so I know that part of this is just streamlining the budget or finding ways that we can save taxpayer money, which is really good. And based on that, I was wondering, in your opinion, what is the benefit of going this route versus doing it in-house? And I ask that because the City of New Carlisle collects taxes. People are used to working with the City of New Carlisle, dealing with the City of New Carlisle, and now it's going to be different. And that's a lot of stuff added to that when you go a different route. What is the benefit for going this route?
Strictly, the benefit is the cost savings and the increased collections we will incur. I understand people don't like change. When you're doing it this way for so many, there's nobody really likes change. And this is something that will allow us, yes, it is a change, but we'll, like I said, we'll always have that tax administrator on staff. Somewhere we'll always be able to walk into our office. But we really have to really look at how much we are paying in salaries and benefits, and we need to get those down, and we need to increase our collections. And that's truly, truly the benefit. Mr. Dennis back there gave some points about what CCA can do and what we can't. And again, for the second time, the big one that is cross-comparing with the federal database. We don't have that capability in here. So they can do a lot more with what we would pay someone to do. If we don't go then, like I said, we'll have to hire another full-time position, more than likely with benefits. And that's going to be well above the 42 to 48 they're going to charge us to do that. So essentially, the way I'm looking at it is, this is going to be our new hire, no benefits, and their output is going to be way much bigger than what an individual person can do just based off that cross comparison of federal database.
And then this would be something we communicate with everyone in the city, letting them know if they're contacted, it'll be through this organization.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
And like I said, you know, it's something that I really do think the city should try for at least 2 years to see what kind of we get back. If it doesn't work, which I have no doubt in my mind that it will work, but we're in a day and an age where small municipalities are like this. We have to look at ways to decrease our expenses, increase our revenues, and this is really the logical way to do that.
Sure.
Thank you, Mr. McIntyre. Mr. Jones.
How many full-time, or how many employees will be dedicated to New Carlisle during the tax season? Is it going to be one, two?
Okay. No, if there will be no one person who is exclusively the Carlisle person and no other community. What we do is we will have one person who is your liaison, who is responsible for communicating with your administration and being the troubleshooter. Your tax returns will come in, from your residents will come in with everybody else's. They will be processed as part of the mail that comes in. They will be batched. So New Carlisle, Cleveland, any other community will be in the same batch, and any a given person on our staff will be working on whatever tax returns are in the bundle they're working on. So there will be no one person who is exclusively working for New Carlisle. But we will have a person who is the expert on New Carlisle, the liaison, who will then be the person to go to. In addition, you have my phone number. Michelle is right here in Dayton, which is not far away, and we are here to deal with issues. I guarantee that if a council member doesn't get a phone call, the city manager will get a phone call from somebody who is unhappy. You never go through a tax season without somebody being unhappy. But when that person calls and they're unhappy, Randy will be able to call either the liaison or me or Michelle, and we will be able to work through what the problem is, determine what needs to be done, and get an answer back. Because, let's face it, we're dealing with taxes. People don't like paying taxes. They're a necessity. But we do not, to answer your question again, no one person will be exclusively working on New Carlisle.
If I could add just a little bit more to that, too. We have a staff of 90 people in Cleveland. So there are basically 90 people that are going to be working on New Carlisle tax returns at all times. During tax season, there'll be two of us, Pam Collins, who's also in our Dayton office. She's here today on her day off. But we will come down and we will pick however many days we need to in the community to help do tax returns. And that's one-on-one, an opportunity where we can sit down with the taxpayers, help them with the forms, prepare the returns, and we'll set that up on several dates. Plus, you still have Vicki for this tax season, which is a very valuable commodity. So I think it'll be a really good transition because of that.
I've read the contract is going to be an executive committee, and it's going to be establishing with the director of finance for the city of Cleveland and four other elected members. Is this something that will be exclusive to each city has their own executive committee? Or?
No, the executive. Each community is a member of the governing board, the committee. And then there is the general membership elects members of the executive committee, which is basically a managing committee that handles the minutia and makes the decisions on behalf of everybody else. We have a quarterly meeting for all of the members, and if you're not able to attend, generally we make it available on speakerphone so that anybody can call in and listen.
Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, did he answer your question, the first one about?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I got a little confusing that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Owens. Mr. Owens.
What's the benefit to the citizens of New Carlisle to deal with Traver?
Well, dealing with CCA, Cleveland is actually a member of the CCA because, again, we're semi-autonomous. I am a city of Cleveland employee, but we have a commissioner who does all the hiring and firing of all the employees for the CCA. Basically, the benefit for your residents is that the community will save money and have hopefully more cash available because we should be able to collect dollars that are not available to you today. We provide, I think, basically all of the services you provide as far as being able to pay online with a credit card, on the phone with a credit card, look up their account online to check the balances, file the tax return online. So we offer full suite of services to the residents. Well, I don't know exactly the extent of the services that your office had provided. One of the disadvantages, to be absolutely honest, is we will not have 40 hours a week somebody sitting in your community. That's one of the trade-offs you accept it. And some residents may take issue with that, and I'm not going to try to deceive you that everybody's going to be happy that they can't walk in any time Monday through Friday between whatever your normal business hours are and talk to somebody.
But we'd still have our tax administrator to talk to, correct?
Yeah.
Mr. Bridge?
She won't have access to their records, their current records.
But she can help.
But she can help.
But if a citizen came in.
But if the citizen came in and they.
Brings documentation, she would be able to help.
I can help them in return.
Yes. That, from that aspect, yes.
What you say about not having a record?
She won't have access to the records till a month later, if I remember correctly, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
We operate, our accounting system uses a hard close at the end of the month versus a real-time system. If you're familiar with accounting, there's two ways of doing it. Real-time is we make entries and the entries become permanent as they're entered in real-time. Our method is the older method where at the end of the month we do trial balances, we look for mistakes, and then close the month, which means that payments made November 7th are subject to review at the end of November for accuracy before they become part of the permanent record, which will then, the month is closed in December. When the month is closed, and if anything is permanent record, then it becomes available to your staff as part of the community access. Your staff does not have access to what we would call a temporary entry pending review and being closed.
However, they do have access to calling any one of us. In the Dayton office, I have access for everything up through the, yesterday. Everything was posted up to the day before. So she can contact our office to verify things. She can contact the liaison. So there is an ability to get anything that might have happened in that short gap between the month closing and when she might need information. So it's still available.
And our residents can call you directly for their own tax.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Actually, we encourage them to come.
Absolutely.
We have the 800 number, call our office. We maintain a telephone bank, and it's the people in that call center are not telephone operators. We rotate staff members, auditors from each department. They spend a week in the call center answering telephone calls. Then at the end of that week, we rotate them out, they go back to their desk and work on whatever their normal job is, and somebody else goes in there. So we have members of our legal team, people who specialize in corporate accounts, withholding accounts, and individual accounts, are all in the on the call center every day. So you're talking to auditors when you call. You're not talking to somebody who is a trainee, because some organizations bring in the new people, put them in the call center with a list of answers, and then if they can't answer, then they push them over to somebody, a supervisor, quote, who will then, or a detail person. Our call center is manned by fresh people every week, once they're up, and these are hands-on people who, for the most part, can handle most of the answers.
I have one more question, and then I'll let somebody else have you. What is your customer service rating from your customers? When people call in, citizens call in, if you have an irate citizen that calls in, how do you want to handle that?
Generally speaking, if somebody at the call center has somebody who has an issue, then we'll come to a supervisor who can resolve the issue.
And that's done immediately?
Yeah. I mean, well, you're going to be honest. Let's be honest. If somebody calls on April 15th, along with everybody else, they're not going to, their phone call is going to be answered within 30 seconds. They're going to be on hold. It's the busiest day of the year in the tax world. But normally, once they're talking to one of our people, if the person they're talking to can't resolve it, we will move them to somebody else who can. And also, I mean, let's face one of the biggest issues people have is a penalty. they get assessed penalty and interest because they're late, or they don't feel that's fair. Now, your administration, council, through ordinance, and the administration on your behalf, determines what the penalties and interest are, and your administration has the ability under your ordinance to abate penalty and interest for good cause. You can determine what is good cause. We have some communities which allow us to, within narrow guidelines, waive penalty and interest. Example being, somebody owes $100 and they can pay it right now, and if they owe $100 and they're going to pay it within 15 days, we'll waive the penalty and just charge the interest, and your administration can give us the authority to do that. If they're not going to do that, then it has to go in writing to administration to make the determination. You may decide that you never waive penalty and interest and you always want it in writing. So, but within the parameters that you give us, our supervisors will do everything they can to satisfy a taxpayer who's on hand.
One of the important things to remember too is that when a taxpayer calls in a lot of cases, they're upset because they don't understand. Education is a very important part of what we do. So it's important for them to understand why they owe the tax, how the tax return was prepared, and in a lot of cases, we can resolve issues just by explaining to them what the process is. So we do everything we can to make sure that they understand, first of all, why there might be a balance or a penalty.
I know, I think the mayor said that we have a large Hispanic population here in New Colorado. We also have a large elderly population in New Colorado. They're retired people, they're in their 70s, 80s, some in their 90s. Some don't hear too well, some gets frustrated. How would you handle those type of people?
For retired people, if their only income is Social Security, if they have that little job, they get a W-2. Those are exactly the type of people we would love to see come in and see us when we come in to do the returns. We'll make sure that administration knows well in advance. As a matter of fact, we'll be scheduling those dates here within the next few weeks for everybody in this area. We'll pick days where it's Saturdays, evenings, during the day, during the week. We'll pick a variety of times, and we encourage you to let your residents know when those dates are and to come in. Pam and I have been in communities where we've had 200 people come in one evening session, and we get through every one of them. So we encourage you to have them come in and see us personally one-on-one.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Kurt Walker.
Okay, I'm the cynic. I'm very cynical in outsourcing. And, the reason for outsourcing is because you can't do it in-house. We outsource the police departments because we can't do it in-house. We outsource a couple of other things. But I think anything finances is the most important department in the city. Without that, we're dead. I mean, we're just dead in the water. And Colleen does a great job. I'm very cynical, I'll just tell you, about outsourcing our taxes, to someplace. I used to work for the Internal Revenue. I know what you're talking about. My question is, for Randy and Colleen, why can't we get the information from the Internal Revenue?
Because we don't have a population of over 250,000. There's only warranted for cities over 250,000 population.
I don't know. Okay.
Yeah. Because the aggregate group of everybody they service, their population is over 250,000.
All right. Two other questions. One is, anytime I used to deal with outsourcing, one of the things is that cost would go up. It would be low in the beginning, but then as time goes on, the costs go up. You did say that we'll start at 2% and it could end up at 3 and could be as high as 4.
Yes.
Well, it's okay.
We originally did our estimates for New Colorado by plugging your tax return numbers into our spreadsheets that we used to calculate, I believe it was the 2014 costs for our membership. So we came up with an estimate based on if you had been a member in 2014, had brought us this many returns, collected that much money, here's what your fee would have been. and I do believe it was closer to 3.5%. So we use 2% as the starting number for the first year. If you want, I mean, probably that 3% would be a more accurate number to use, and we can collect that. Number one, if you go to 2%, when we do the recalculation, you are going to have been, a minimal amount will have been, an inaccurate amount will have been held back. Even with the numbers we're looking at today, we know that. The first thing to remember is, you will never write a check to the CCA. If the amount held back is not adequate to cover your actual expenses, we will adjust future deposits to until that is made up. So that the actual expenses you are paying are based on the formula, meaning if your revenue collection goes up, if the number of tax returns you process goes up, and the tax returns processed for our members and the tax the revenue collected for our members is stagnant, your costs will go up because we're doing more for you. But it's always going to be a calculation based on transactions and revenue. And on our website, we have a list of all the communities, and it shows the transactions, the revenue for them, and how the calculation is made. It's a public record. We can show it to you. It will be a public record as a member. So you won't be able to go in and say, yep, same formula year after year. We've been using this formula since 1966. It has not changed.
Okay, you said that the cost is inclusive of everything. But in your contract, it says it is mutually understood and agreed that any assessed additional cost shall be due and owing as of and from the date of the notice of additional costs and expenses. You know, so what does that mean?
Okay. First, I'm not an attorney to interpret the contract, but speaking as somebody who's worked through the process, if you had decided that you wanted a service that is outside of our normal operations, that we do not provide for everybody else, and you want something, and I'm trying to think of what it might be, I'm trying to think of something we don't normally do for it. Let's say you want custom tax returns made for some reason, and you insist that you have a special page only on a new Colorado tax return that no other community is using. That cost would be borne by you exclusively because it is not something that is done for everybody. I mean, I have a hard time because, to best my knowledge, we've never hit that. And by virtue of full disclosure, there is one exception which has happened once.
One time. The city of Dayton, and like I said, they have a special membership with us where we do delinquency work. They asked us to appoint a prosecutor to take cases to court for them, and they bore the cost of that. The cost of that program, I think, was about $100,000, and it brought in about $450,000 for them.
That's the only one I know of. Now, that's part of the FTI. I'm going to be going deeper than I would normally go into stuff, but just for full disclosure, FTI has special rules. As you are aware, the IRS is very cognizant that their data is private. They impose special conditions upon our use of that data. The information that we get from the IRS is housed on separate servers in separate rooms, all stacked up by the IRS. They come in and audit our security once a year. And I'm saying that when we use federal tax information, the special audit group that does this work has access to federal information, but that information is not shared with any other employee of CCA. And if we're sending a letter to taxpayers based on federal tax information, nobody knows who's on that list except the special audit people who are preparing it. And when somebody refuses to answer, because if you said, well, who's getting these letters? Well, so we can't tell you. If you call the tax commissioner and ask him, he doesn't know. Only the special audit people know. Now, once somebody files their tax return, that tax return goes into the main operation. It's no longer private under IRS regulation because the source of the data is now the taxpayer, not the IRS. Excuse me. But if we go through the entire process of FTI, it's inevitable that there is somebody who is not going to respond. At that point in time, when we've exhausted everything, the IRS allows us to file a lawsuit to collect taxes from those informations, but to do so, we must use an attorney that has been vetted by the IRS to receive the confidential information. Even to the point where we're saying, okay, we're going to sue these people, and we would come to you and say, we have four taxpayers. Based on the information, there's a potential to collect, based on the information we have available, $50,000 in taxes. However, you will have to bear the cost of that special prosecutor, because that is not part of our normal operations. And then we will say, well, how much is the special prosecutor? And we'll say, $20,000. And you're going to say, well, do we want to spend $20,000 on maybe collecting $50,000 from four or five people? And you make a judgment call on that and decide to do it or not. Generally speaking, by the time we get to that point, the risk and reward doesn't favor hiring a special prosecutor for most communities. I mean, it's just simply that's the facts.
Okay.
So that is the one time you made up official money.
Thank you, Mr. Caldwell. Mr. McIntyre.
In the beginning, you mentioned the online payment options. I was wondering if you could sort of extrapolate a bit on that, how it works. And sometimes we may have residents who aren't as comfortable using digital devices as others and how they're assisted. Just sort of walk through and how this online system works.
Well, basically, you can go to our website, log in with the password is created. You can then go in, access the account, and say, this is a determination of how much you want to pay it with a credit card online. Now, there's no additional fees for paying online with a credit card with us. Going back to your question, though, because I'm not asking, I can't walk the step by step through every screen. It's probably no different than going to Amazon, really, about using a credit card. But if we have somebody who is not comfortable, we do it over the phone. I personally, I've had people call up and say, I only have $250, I'm going to pay it over the phone. Say, fine. What's your social security number? What credit card? I fill out the slip. And everything else, I say, okay, $200 charged to your MasterCard, this number, you agree? Yes, about fine. We take it over the phone, I give them a confirmation number that comes back from the credit card company, here's a confirmation that's been accepted. Would you like me to mail you the receipt? And if they want us to mail the receipt, I take a copy of the receipt, put it in an envelope and mail it to them. If they don't want it, we don't.
We also walk through step by step on how to actually do it online if they want to do it themselves. Usually that first time, once they've gone through the steps and they understand how it works, they're really much more comfortable with it. So whichever way they want to do it, if they want to be able to be hands-on and do it on their own, we'll walk them through step by step and help them get that process done. Or we can just simply take the payment for them, whichever they prefer.
Sure. One more thing before we wrap up, move on. I just want to say, myself, Ms. Harris, and Ms. Taylor did our research. We had also sat down with City of Vandalia, and we also looked at RITA, which is another outsourcing income tax agency. We actually had a meeting with City of Vandalia, had a meeting with CCA. We knocked RITA out just for reasons that I wanted to discuss on an open council meeting, but we decided that RITA wasn't the best option for our citizens. We did meet with Vandalia, we met with CCA, based off the customer service research that I've done and Ms. Taylor has done as well. We felt that CCA was our best option for our citizens. So we did look at other places that can do the same thing.
Mr. Bridger, another question. This is going to be a savings of ballpark of $35,000. That way we don't have to hire another person for multiple reasons. Haven't we talked about hiring more people?
Not in the finance basically for accounts payable and stuff like that.
So if we were to do this, would this free us up to do things like the online checkbook, possibly?
It will alleviate a lot of stress.
Online water bill pays down the road?
Well, the water is another issue, but it will alleviate for us to focus on other areas that we simply don't have the man hour to focus on now.
So if this goes through, we won't be looking at hiring anybody in the office?
Not anytime soon. We will hire somebody probably and the next hire we make inside the office will probably be more for accounts payable and stuff like that.
Okay. So if this did pass, potentially having to hire two people, or at least one for sure.
We're going to have to hire some people if this doesn't pass, yes.
Okay.
That's pretty much a given at this point.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Lindsay?
Mr. Hitch, if we do this and send outsource our tax department, so to speak, what would the tax administrator's duties be?
She's going to help with the transition. And we also need to keep the tax administrator on staff too. So if a citizen would happen to come in, that she can actually be that liaison if that particular taxpayer does not want to call them directly.
Okay.
But in the meantime, she's going to be helping out with that transition from where we are now to getting everything converted over, our data and all that stuff. So she'll be retained for that.
And you said that she would be, could be reevaluated in June?
Yes.
On Vicki now, correct?
Yes, but that goes to the day-to-day operations of the city, so we'll discuss that not on the council meeting.
Ms. Harris?
One of our goals also is the collection part that we've always wanted to put. We used to outsource. I think one of you brought that up, and that was a little effective. We tried to do it in-house with the staff, but we were just running into so much to do in our day-to-day. So the tax administrator, after she helps with the transition, the next best thing also in our, you know, checking what her future will be, the collections is our number one. They're going to take care of the current year and the year after, correct? And we'll be able to start digging through all the older ones and really get a lot of that receivables we've had on the books for a long time. We've been doing a little bit, but I think we're going to have a lot more effort with just the one person and staff, because hiring them is our second employee, except we get their whole group. We get all of them. We get their attorneys, we get their collection, we get the people in Dayton, and for less than we can get one person in-house.
It's kind of like the sheriff's.
Exactly.
Contract.
You're getting
more. We're going to lose the one fuzzy feeling if we had our own police department.
But not.
We get more bells and whistles by contracting.
But we're still in the office. We are still there. If anybody wants to come in and ask a question, we're just not going to post the receivables that we collect in-house. That's going to be their job. That money will go to them to collect and to record. But we're still there to answer questions. We're still there Monday through Friday. We'll still be customer service.
Mr. Craybaugh, something you said about outsourcing, and please take it in the way I'm saying it to you. I have a lot of respect for you. Now, I have to disagree with you a little bit, just like my uncle just said about the sheriff's department. This has been an ongoing problem for years, this tax. We've got to do something different.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not, and when you spoke about outsourcing, we got the sheriff, not because we couldn't do it. We couldn't do it as good. We don't have the resources that the sheriff's department has. We don't have the money to buy the resources that the sheriff's department has. And it's the same way, in my opinion, with this group of people. We do not have the money to buy the resources that they have or to get the resources they have. And, you know, I just want to clarify, it's not that we can't do it. We cannot do it as good. It would be great if we could, you know, we could hire four or five people and 2 million dollars to go after all those people that don't want to pay their taxes, you know, but we're not in that situation. And, I wish you would look at it a little bit more.
And I think, too, if I might add, if you guys read, you got the termination of the contract. We are at any point in time allowed to exit if it follows the condition that, one, it happens on December 31st of that year, and it has to be in prior to July 1st of June.
July 1st.
July 1st. So we have it now. It's not like we're stuck in this. And I think the city really does need to start thinking outside the box and get this income tax collection nips in the bud. There's a lot of things the city has been taking advantage of, and I think people not being held accountable for not filing or not paying is one of them. And I tell you what, as a citizen of this town, yeah, at first I'm like, yeah, it might be a little weird that I have to file my taxes with another city, but at the same time, if it's collecting all this stuff that other people have not paid, I'd be all for it. We'll get comments and public comments of the public, if you have your chance. No, we do it here, Nancy.
Okay, so, we are, Mr. Burke?
All right, yeah, let's move on. I'm gonna get myself in order here. All right, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, members of the public, I would like to share with you the city manager's report. First item up for discussion, I'm happy to report that we are just about finally done with Twin Creeks. I don't know if you guys saw that board there. The city will retain $8,939.33. I have that further broken down. Out of that $8,939, Daniels and Jeffrey was hired to assist us with this project. That was $577. Our attorney fees from our city law attorney, Ms. Dinkler, was about $1,818. We had withheld $3,600 for lawn maintenance, and we have also withheld $1,830.83 for my times that I put into it, and then also we retained $1,113 in various fees that we paid that we did not have to pay. If that came down to it, my total man hours on the project, this is estimated, is about 57 hours. So a little over a whole week spattered throughout the time. But again, I am happy to report that we will retain the $8,939.33. The remaining balance of that 189 sell price that we did, the $180,060.60 will be sent back to the county auditor to reimburse those respective taxing jurisdictions, districts, sorry. We will also see some money coming back that as well, since we didn't get some past tax years that were not paid. I don't have a dollar amount on that yet, but as soon as we know that exact dollar amount, I will share that with council. But I am happy to report when I took over, one of the things we wanted to get done together as a team was get rid of Twin Creeks. That is now officially done. Kennedy Trust is done. And you just got the elephant in the room, which is Madison Street School. We'll tackle that in the next couple of years. But long, long battle. A lot of you have been there with Twin Creeks, but it's over. So hats off to everybody for pulling together and getting that done. Since there is not the middle of the month, we're going to skip down there to informational items. Now, don't kill me on my brochure that I copied and put in here. I know it's really hard to read, but we wanted to give council an idea of what was going to be coming. So basically, this is going to be essentially a brochure that's going to have a tear-off thing down here that Waste Management is going to send out to every citizen. Once you get this brochure in the mail, you're simply going to choose your service level. If you are a senior citizen and you do require that 65 or over senior rate, you are going to have to send a copy of your driver's license in with this, okay? And that's going to prove to them that you are 65 or older and you can get the $9 rate. I have slightly good news. I spoke with Tom, who is our contact with Waste Management. Instead of switching out everybody's recycling containers, since everybody already has a 96-gallon recycling container, you're more than welcome to keep that, regardless of what service level you're on. So if you are a senior and you want to go for the 35, they're not going to switch you out with the smaller recycling. They're going to let you keep your 96. That's the same for the low volume. So if you want to go on the 65-gallon cart, they're going to let you keep your existing 96. That's the flush work for them to do to switch everything out, but also gives our citizens a little more bang for their buck. So basically, when you get this brochure, you are going to see that the new carts will be delivered the week of November 28th, and that's if and only if Waste Management has your postcard back to them by 11:25.
We will get that in the mail.
That is being developed. I did a complete address database of all the single and two-family homes a couple weeks ago and sent them off to Waste Management, so they have everything they need. Be honest with you, so far I've actually got great feedback about this Waste Management contract. You know, I've had some people come in and say, it's kind of not for me, I kind of like the bags, but there's been far more people come in supporting the service level choices. It's a really, truly a fair pay for what you play. So glad to hear that. Moving on, we have shelter house updates. I know that we have submitted quotes for various projects within the shelter house. We're still waiting on a few more. So once we have the remaining few quotes we have, we'll bring everything back together. I will present that as a whole packet to council, and you guys amongst yourselves can decide what's the best course for the city and how we're going to put money back into the shelter house. Smoke-free parks. We did the grant opportunity, which got us the playground equipment over here. And Sarah, the awesome lady over at the health district who helped out with this, she actually did a pre and a post study of the tobacco-related waste around in our parks. So before we council passed a resolution for that 20-foot ban, she had found 66 cigarette butts, one chewing tobacco lid, one cigarillo wrapper, and two plastic cigarette tips. Well, in October, when she just did it, she just did like 2 weeks ago, she found two cigarette packs, six cigarette butts, three plastic cigarette tips, and one cigar wrapper. So you're looking at a reduction of 66 cigarette butts down to six since we passed this resolution. Hats off to you guys for doing that. I will add that we were the very first in Clark County to institute this kind of ban around our playground equipment. But there's no reason why our youngest citizens have to be around secondhand smoke when they're playing on playground equipment. So thanks for council for passing that resolution. We are seeing the direct results, positive results with that program. I lost my spot again. Oh, okay, here we go. Employee Christmas party will be this Friday, December 16th at 12:15 p.m. It will be right here in the shelter house. Council, you are encouraged to attend, and city operations will close at noon on that day to accompany the Christmas party. I think about the same time we closed last year. The party did close at 12:15. So 7 council members, if you have some time, please stop in and we'll have a good time like we do always, every year. Leaf pickup, we brought that back. Our citizens passed the police levy, and our funds are looking a lot better. So we did bring back the leaf pickup. We will also be bringing back linen brush pickup as well. But I did include that flyer in with council packets so you guys can have some information if your constituents do ask you a little bit more about that program. How do you think that's taken off so far? Pretty good?
Well, it's been excellent.
So response is pretty good on it. I do believe that's all I have for the city manager's report. I'd be happy to entertain any questions.
Well, I have none of them pertain to anything you talked about.
Okay.
Several meetings ago, there was a Boy Scout, I believe an Eagle Scout.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe it was the younger ones, that were going to put the library, the book box outside.
Girl Scouts.
Did that happen or did it not?
Well,
I've never seen it.
No, funny thing, I called, it hasn't been any time soon. Probably about 2 months after they come and nothing happened, I called. Apparently they have an issue securing the actual newspaper box.
They don't have a what?
They're having an issue securing an old newspaper thing. So I don't know if that's still a holdup or not. Now it's getting close, I just assumed it probably would come in the spring.
Well, I hadn't seen it. I was hoping that it didn't happen.
Yeah.
Rather than it did happen, someone stole it. That was what
no,
I
thought. No, I stole it. No.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
The parade. Are we going to have a parade? I talked to Gene earlier.
Parade.
Yeah, Gene Carter and
Christmas parade.
I don't think we'll be having a
parade.
Yeah, okay.
Marshall's had meetings on the Christmas parade.
So it's not a city event?
No.
Yeah, I don't know anything about it. It's not a city event. This is a
parade. Do you have any
Sorry, I thought you wanted to put a Christmas parade together in a month and a half. I just like, okay. Fair enough.
Mr. Evans,
all right, quick one. Just so that everyone's clear, this is from the Twin Creeks money. It was from payment for the 33 parcels, not the settlement.
No, the settlement's a totally different way.
Exactly.
The 27 parcels that we sold for $189,000,
yeah.
That's what that comes
exactly.
out.
Exactly. Okay, I just want to make that clear.
Sure.
Any other questions? Thank you, Mr. Burge.
Mm-hmm.
And moving on to comments from the members of the public. Ms. Marshall, are you ready? Glad you're up in the office.
Hi there, Kathy Marshall here, resident and grandma to my fifth grade grandson from Tecumseh Cubs.
Kathy, can you give your address for Gene, please?
403 Westlake Avenue.
Thank you.
Tecumseh Cubs varsity just won their league championship.
Thank you.
And my dad, thank you, Mr. Burge. one question and if it just one comment. First, let's go with the comment. Vicki Taylor, great gal, done a terrific job in the tax department. She's overwhelmed. She needs extra help. And listening to the presentation, that could be the answer. That's up to you guys. One thing, Carleen, when you were talking about Vicki working on past collections, is that something that the city could check on using the Attorney General for in that regard? I don't know if anybody's ever checked the prices of that.
I haven't checked on it. We were kind of working with them on how much they'll take and what we have left to do. But we have not, I think when our former tax administrator was able to process maybe 5 people to court, and I don't believe we've done any for the last 10 years.
Right.
It's just, and again, understaffed, so much to do. And of course, the tax changes last year and the House bill and the income tax, there was just a lot going on. But that is a big goal, is to get this collections, the old.
Well, I know you mentioned the Attorney General. I know that they've been doing some good work with that. And if you're not going to be working on the back tax collection, you know, that could be maybe an option. I didn't know what the cost would be on that. But like I said, I think Vicki will need whatever help she can get. She worked extremely hard to get everything ready, paperwork and stuff for the deadlines. And she has helped. Amy has helped her. And it's just, but she put in a lot of time. And there's just I don't even think 2 people could help her. I think you'd need a huge staff to be able to get back and get everything going. So I just wanted to say that. And Bill, thank you very much for all your time.
Thank you.
You've done a great job. And thanks to all the veterans for that coming up. And I think that's it.
Well, you don't have anything about city manager on that piece of paper? It's good. Don't answer that.
Nancy Lovanovich, 505 P's. I'll start right off by saying I don't like outsourcing because, number one, it gives my information to other people. And with all the hackers they got going around, I think they would rather hack a big company than a little city like New Carlisle. The other thing is you're talking about a 2 or 3% charge. Would we be charged that in the beginning or at the end of this time period? And if it does have a lot of the unthinkable things happen, would that put us up to a different during that time period that we're trying to get a source of what it's going to cost us? Is that what's going to change it? You know, I mean, you're trying to tell us what's involved, but anytime you tell me that it's all encompassing, I'm going, no, something's going to show up, okay? The people, I worked in tax offices, granted it wasn't as big as yours, but even in that small one, people came, they left, people didn't show up that didn't have the same understanding of a particular, I mean, they tried to make it the same person as a liaison, but it doesn't always work that way. It just doesn't, and especially in a large company. So that was another concern. And you were talking about having having the charges for these things that we were asking that nobody else was asking. At that point in time, would we be able to negotiate with anybody else to see if we wanted that particular thing done, or would we be tied to your company?
Okay, so let's start with the last one first.
Okay.
The scenario where we're addressing a unique item that would be outside of the contract, I can't really comment because I'm not aware of what's in the lab since 1966 that it's really happened. So I don't know the answer to that. But
if it's, you're not talking about a service that we don't provide and you want to seek it through another source.
No, that you provide, but we want to get a negotiated rate.
Then, well, because everything we charge is a pass-through of actual costs.
Okay.
It's not like we have a markup that, oh, it's going to cost us $100, we're going to charge you $110.
Okay, because you did the groundwork, so you're not going to let anybody else say, no, we can do it cheaper because you, we haven't done the groundwork. Not that one. Okay, I think, you know, basically what I said, so I just, it strikes me wrong whenever you say outsource, and it strikes me wrong when you say all inclusive. My opinion. And I don't want to lose her at all.
Thank you, Nancy. Victoria, we'll get to you then. Go ahead.
I'm Victoria Porter, 210 West Madison Street. I actually have a couple questions about the tax thing. You'd made a mention about deferred or the assessments, the quarterly taxes, that you were not going to follow up with those if they didn't file on their tax return?
No.
Okay. That's what I'm asking. I misunderstood that.
Generally, when you fill out the tax return, there's a line for you to declare your estimated taxes for the upcoming year.
Right.
If you leave that line blank, we read that as zero. We don't bill you for anything because you didn't give us a number to bill you for.
Okay.
Some communities will insert a number for you if you leave it blank.
Okay.
We don't do it that way. The idea is the number you have on the line is the amount you bill for. If the line is blank, it's a zero. You won't get a bill.
Okay, so from my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, Vicki, but the quarterly taxes or the quarterly estimates are a city ordinance?
Yes, that is correct.
And they are required. So would you, if someone left that balance, follow up with that to find out if that was a true zero or if that was something that they just decided they didn't want to pay?
Well, that truth comes out in the wash when you file your annual tax return. If you declare a zero estimate or even one, you would say, I'm not anticipating all the annual taxes when I file my annual return next April.
Okay.
When that tax return comes in and there are no estimated taxes paid, you will be penalized for failure to pay estimated taxes.
Okay. That answered my question. Thank you very much. My next question was, is if this did not come through, and we 2 years down the road, we decide this isn't working for us and we want to back out of it. The taxes that you have collected at that point, all the returns, all the information, does that come back to the city or does that become your property?
Okay. The data is the property of the community.
Okay.
It is not ours.
Okay.
We have the physical tax returns. After a period of time, they're stored electronically. So that we are the repository for the information. If you were to leave, that information is available to you as long as the statute is open on that data.
Okay.
Generally, printing out copies and sorting out and pulling out that individual tax returns and boxing them and shipping them here is not practical.
Okay.
And the money goes to us anyway.
Well, it's your money. It is the community's money.
Okay, you pay that 2% then, or you take the 2%?
Well, okay. The cost comes out of collection, so that if we are under contract to collect money for you today, we will take our fee out of that collection until the contract terminates. Well, after the contract terminates, we're not authorized to collect for you, we're just going to forward everything to you.
Okay, that makes sense. I trust that.
Very good question.
Oh, I'm not done. Going off of the tax portion, I actually want to bring up something that we dropped because of the budget. And Holly, this one's for you. Are we going to bring back the spring cleanup? I am like the first person that people call. And I have a lot of people that have a lot of complaints. And the code enforcement can only do so much. I know that spring cleanup, a lot of people relied on that.
Spring cleanup was huge a couple times, and then it really got where we didn't need many dumpsters. then we cut it out during the bad budget year, and I'm in the works with the Clark County Combined Health District and the Waste Management District to see if we can get it back at a reduced rate to the city.
Cool. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Sir?
I'll be really fast, but I'm not going to talk about taxes, so.
That's a relief. Don Hall, 305 North Scott Street. Spoke to you guys a couple months ago about a nuisance abatement. We had a house on Scott Street that was somewhat of a disturbance. I just wanted to thank you, Mr. Mayor, and City Council, along with the City Manager, and most importantly, the deputies. Literally, the next day after I spoke, I had a car posted out in front of my house. And I know we talked about the limitations and everything else, but as a guy that's just kind of always has an eye on the community and on my street, I'll say the trafficking at that house has greatly decreased. If anything, you spooked them. It was just definitely a relief knowing that you can actually voice a concern and a community response. Just as one of 6,000, I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks for coming, sir.
Thank you.
Roger here is getting straight by, and thank you, deputies. Any other questions from the comments from the community? Before we move on. All right. Thank you. And we'll move on to committee reports on tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Resolutions for tonight. We'll move down to the ordinances. We have three introductions and four of action.
Order 16-42, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance to authorize the city manager to enter into a service agreement with the Ohio Department of Administrative Services and the Office of Information Technology for Mark's Radio Services.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Irvin.
I move to accept ordinance 16-42.
Second.
Who's that? Mr. Reynolds, is that you?
Yep.
Second.
Yeah, okay.
Explanation to this ordinance. This ordinance will allow us for me to sign an agreement to go in by these heavily reduced Mark's radios. As you can tell by the reading of the language in the ordinance, in 2018, the state of Ohio will require all fire and EMS departments to utilize this Mark's radio system. So our fantastic fire chief down here got a great deal. These are leftovers from the Democratic convention. I do believe that was in Cleveland, correct? So, basically we just got a heavily reduced deal on them. I think it's definitely the best interest of the city to purchase these, given the 2018 deadline by the state wire.
Mr. Reynolds.
I think we should definitely go and purchase these. I don't know if you know, the convention is literally 5 days, and most of the time they just walk around. And the federal government requires us to buy these originally for our deputies when I first came on council, and I know there was some hit and misses with them, but now they seem to be doing well, so I think we should definitely pass this. Even if they are Democratic radios.
Mr. Reynolds said this was something about interoperability, which is a word that's as hard to spell as it is pronounced. The federal government after 9/11, when 9/11 happened, there was a big problem where people couldn't talk to each other, fire departments, port authority, everyone, because they're on different frequencies or different systems. This is a way that if there was a disaster, to make sure that all first responders can work with each other, talk to each other. And in the past years, we've talked about it, and I think it's worked out pretty great as far as its usefulness of the department. I know there were a few hiccups when we first started, but it is a federal requirement. I guess it's also now a state requirement. And so hopefully this continues to work out well in our favor.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. Council, any other questions? Mr. Carter, on your order, please.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybacker?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passes 7-0.
Ordinance 16-43, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing agreement with the City of Cleveland, Ohio for services relating to income tax collections.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lawler.
Motion to adopt ordinance 16-43.
Second.
Is that Mr. McIntyre?
Yes, sir.
And explanation of this ordinance will allow me to sign the contract to outsource our income tax collections.
Mr. McIntyre.
During the conversation that we had, and I thank you again for coming, providing this insight, I made a list of pros and cons that I just want to kind of get off all of us or decide where we are. As far as the cons go, one is obviously the fee. I think the highest it said was 5% or in the legislation, maybe it was 3, but yeah, between 2 and 5%. Yikes, don't really like that. Another one is it's out of the city's hands. I know Nancy brought up outsourcing, John brought up problems with outsourcing. People wouldn't like, you know, like you said, change is hard. And people don't like outsourcing. Those were some of the two big cons. I had another con, which was the blank item if you leave that part of your income tax blank, not paying. But I know that you went through that and mentioned that, so I removed that. So those were the two cons I had. As far as the pros go, one, it's a savings for the city. As we saw, it's about $35,000. That's money that we can use for other resources. There's tools we don't have. The federal database, some of the other options are things that we can't get for a city for our size in the same way that we use the sheriff's department, because they have detectives and they have the jails and they have abilities that we don't have. Three is the online payment, which is something that I think everyone up here has been pushing for, hoping we could get for a while now, and it's really nice to know that that's an option. And four is the issues with delinquent taxes. We can start to tackle these, I think, in a little bit better light than what we've been able to do beforehand because of just your natural issues of manpower and time. So those are some of the issues I have, both pros and cons. Really, I could see any way here. I think one thing that might be the kicker is that we would exit at any time or exit after 2 years if we're not happy about it.
There's no minimum 2 years. It's just,
so if we just say this is
everything goes to December 31st, like if February 17th, for some reason we said we're done.
Yeah,
we're
right.
Soon into it. We still have to be under contract until December 31st, 17, as long as we let them know by January 1st.
Yeah, and I'm glad no one was losing their job, as you mentioned there. So yeah, four or five really good pros. The cons are pretty big cons, but you know, the leaving at any time, that's also a great deal too, if this isn't something that we want to continue doing.
Sure.
To follow up on Mr. McIntyre's cons, I think our Hispanic community, I could see problems with language barriers. I believe you said you had Spanish-speaking people on staff. Also, another concern that I have is our senior citizens. They don't get computers. They have hard time having phones. Some of them can't get out. So I think that's another concern we have. I know some of the senior citizens has people come to their house to do their returns for them. I just wanted to make those comments.
Thank you, Mr. Lindsay. Council, any other questions, comments?
Mr. Cooper. I'm going to really miss you, I'm going to tell you. Because you know, now I'm kind of on the fence and see how that happens. I'm still not convinced that's the best way. You know, nothing against Vicki, and I know she's a hard worker. I've known Vicki for years, too. Before I was even on council. I've known Vicki, and I know that's a hard job. I probably couldn't do it. I'd buckle under it. But I'm just telling you, I just on the fence. See what the course.
That is why you're a councilman, sir. You're allowed to be on the fence.
I'm going
to
be on the fence.
Yes, do what you need to do.
I do what I can do.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr-Walker. I'll just throw in my 2 cents again. Over the past few years, when our budget has been extremely tight and has looked extremely bad. When the new bond was printed out of budget for the end of the year was just embarrassing.
And we've had numerous people come to our council meeting and say, you need, telling us, we need to think outside the box. Let's think outside the box and save some dollars. You know, council has in the past argued over, you know, spending $2,000 at times, or $4,000. So I think for not taking, in my opinion, is to not to even give this a try would not be the best interest in the city. You know, change is something that nobody likes, it makes everybody nervous, you lose that comfort feeling you get. But to not try to save an estimated $35,000, I think, you know, in my opinion, it's not responsible to not at least try it.
I said, I hope it's later.
Any other?
Those things don't turn out the way you want them to.
Never know unless you don't try.
And that's all I'm saying, Nancy. It's, it's.
You tried to launch it up and got burned on it.
And that's why I said, try, me personally, so. Any other questions or comments before we move on? Mr. Carter, when you're ready.
Mr. Reynolds?
No.
Mr. Lindsay?
No.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
I believe Mr. McIntyre went through everything, and I believe that the pros outweigh the negativity of the other things that we came up with. And I think it's worth trying. We can all step out of it. If not, if we have a savings of the amount of money that we're talking about, that's going to be a feather in the hat. I'd rather be there, sir. My vote is yes for this, for a trial period.
Mr. Craybacher?
No.
Mr. Lowry? Mr. Mike Lowry?
Yes.
No Lowry.
I'd like to give it at least a try, yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
For once, I get to be the deciding vote. Yes.
There you go.
Give it a try.
Pass 4-3.
How convenient.
Yes.
Welcome, Dr. Lowry. And he's leaving, so we can't take the heat for it. Make sure you remove his phone number from the website.
I'm clearly.
Mr. Carter, when you're ready, sorry.
Ordinance 16-45, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance amending sections 220 of the codified ordinances of the city of New Carlisle, Ohio, regarding the city manager.
Council, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion for ordinance 16-45.
Second.
Who's that, Mr. Craybacher first?
Yeah.
And Mr. Reynolds?
Correct.
Explanation of this ordinance, this needed to be cleaned up for multiple reasons. One, first off, if you read the original language on it, it says the city manager accrues their vacation, but yet can't carry any over, which makes no sense, because when I'm supposed to just donate my vacation in November and December, so I can't carry it over. So this is allow up to the same page as everyone else in the city, eight weeks to carry over. And also there's a prorated basis if I was going to get terminated or leave the city for any cause. Hmm.
Council, any questions, comments?
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Craybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passes 6-0. 7-0. Ordinance 16-46, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 11-21-16. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract for the renewal of health insurance. Ordinance 16-47E, introduction, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance adding the recycle bank to the new waste management contract effective December 1, 2016, and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Mayor.
Can I make a comment before you guys go into that? Am I allowed?
Sure.
I didn't get my chance. I don't recommend this ordinance passing. And here's the reason why. 18.4% of our population use that, and it's an all-in or all-out. So basically, if you don't want to be in it, but person B does,
they can't shoot, because it's all in or all out. I did ask for updated stats on the participation in the city. It's still at 18.4%. Keep in mind that this does pass, that those rates that we had previously passed for the waste backup are going to go up, and I included that into this packet.
Say it again one more time. You said if it does or does not pass?
If it does pass, it's 50 cents extra.
Okay.
Now, when we talked about this first time, I didn't know this. I just assumed it was included into the current product, I mean, current package that we have. Talked to some other citizens too. They didn't assume they were paying 50 cents extra for the service last year as well, and years prior. But it is, it's not included into the actual active recycling is, but the recycling bank costs 50 cents extra. So again, I will leave that up to you guys to decide. I've got some feedback from some citizens. One, they didn't even realize they even had a program. And then two, they don't want to pay 50 cents extra for stuff they don't really get.
If someone's in this program now and they have a bunch of points built up,
I would get rid of them before December 1st.
Yeah, I would just like to clarify what you said. Earlier you said we were going to be keeping our recycling bins. This isn't getting rid of recycling for the city.
No, this is that recycling.
This is that recycling that we signed up for points or whatever the situation may be.
Exactly.
So it does not affect. We will continue to have the recycling. You can fill that 96-gallon container up, and they'll pick it up every other.
Sure. Yeah. This is just for you to log into. I guess there's a portal you go to, and you say you have X amount of points, and I want this.
Yeah, I just
this
want to.
It's similar to like Speedway's points.
Speedway's points.
AutoZone.
If you want the raw numbers, there are 2,022 addresses available to be to the recycling bank, and that's 2,022. Out of those 2,022, only 372 actually participated. So, again, decisions up to council. I don't recommend it pass. I think that we got a lot of good feedback on our current pricing that we have, and now we're going to up that by 50 cents if this goes through.
Again, as long as the recycling doesn't go away,
no,
I think that's very valuable for us to pay our city.
Yeah. This is just a point system that the city approves. And I did include on the back of that, you see that second box down there, the price increase if they do go with the recycling bank keeping them. So for example, the senior rate, which has been phenomenally reviewed and received by our senior citizen population, instead of it being $9 the first year a month, it's going to go up to $9.50. It's going to raise your quarterly cost by easily $1.50. However, when you get to year 2, 3, and 4, you see that percentage of how much they charge you over and above from previous years. Year 2 is going to go from $9.23 with the recycle bank up to $9.75. And that goes to $9.46 for year 3 up to $9.99, and then $10.24 on year 4. So I really think council should probably look at how many people actually take part in this program versus how much of an increase our citizens across the board entirely are going to have to improve with such a small amount of participation.
Mr. Mayor. So you're recommending we let this back?
Yes, I am.
I just wanted to clarify again.
And Mr. Lauer, I'm sorry for interrupting you. I just wanted to get that
fine
for you guys.
It's your question. No, I'm glad you did.
Sure.
Anybody made a motion?
All right.
No, nobody's made a motion.
I'm getting ready. I'm not going to get
a
thank you, Mr. Bridge, for interrupting Mr. Lowry.
No problem.
So I officially declare that order 16-47E died to a lack of a motion.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
When you're ready, sir.
Under other business, Crime Watch meeting will be Wednesday, November the 9th here at Smith Park Shelter House, and that starts at 6:30 p.m., and that is open to the public. City offices will be closed on Friday, November the 11th for Veterans Day, Thursday, November 24th for Thanksgiving, and Friday, November 25th for the day after Thanksgiving. And the intergovernmental meeting will be Monday, November the 28th, 6:30 p.m. That's hosted by City of Newcastle here at Smith Park Shelter House. And that is also open to the public.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Birch, could you, is there a way you can get a hold of the gentleman from CCA? There's some people that want to hear that whole speech again.
Are you kidding? Oh, from the beginning?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can get it. Can you just YouTube it and send me the link? Because I don't want to sit through it again. That'd be like the third time I've sat through it, yes.
He did give me a sign and say, all right, how many minutes of presentation? I went, whoa.
I didn't, because your email said brief presentation, so.
Thank you for letting me sit through that. I know it was the most entertaining. So, Russ, Council, as you were, Mr. Birch.
I have a question for Mr. Birch and Mrs. Harris. It's a kind of, I don't know which one of you want to answer it.
If I don't know the answer, I'll send it to Ms. Harris. That's how you handle it.
Well, that's why I mentioned you in the comment. A few months ago, we did a resolution for the online checkbook. How is that coming along?
We will probably be able to put more power, more attention to it in the coming months since this has been approved. But as I more than once stated when you guys had approved that it probably would not happen anytime soon. I had first gave a target date around September, then I seconded that up by I wouldn't be surprised if it's first of the year. So it is still intact. We still have every intention on doing it, but we just don't have the time right now. Yes. But I will say that my opinion on it was changed during that presentation. And when I was at the last conference I was at about 2 weeks ago, I actually sat on that presentation again. And I'm still thoroughly excited for it because it's something that I can use, Ms. Harris can use, you all can use to better go through that tons of data that we call finances. And it breaks it down to the graph. So prior to that, I wasn't too excited about it. I am now, but it's simply just coming to a manpower thing. We're getting ready to do our capital improvement for 2017. We got our budgets coming up for 2017. So knowing all that then, I said probably September, but then I kind of backed it up, said first of the year. So now we're on the first of year target, but we are on every intention on doing it.
So in January, I can ask you about it.
You can ask me, yeah, absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ramsey. Mr. Lavelle.
I just want to tell everybody, please go out tonight sometime and vote.
Absolutely.
It is your right.
I think he read it and then he decided to steal the thunder on that. And if you have not voted, please go out and vote tomorrow if you would please. We'll know the night, how everything came out on everyone. This has probably been the toughest election that any of us will ever face with the two candidates we have for president. So please, have a vote for our vote.
Yeah, one more time, I just wanted to say thank you to the councilman, or just Bill.
Mr. Mayor,
I mean Bill.
I move major.